usually spend about 10 or 15 minutes giving an introduction, but because we have so many people, I'm not going to do that. So maybe you can all clap for that, because that might be a lot of fun. It's a great honor. I've been representing the 1st District of Idaho now for 7 years, and it's been a great honor to represent the people of Idaho. I really enjoy doing town hall meetings. I enjoy meeting with the constituents, and I've been doing them consistently since I was first elected. I'm going to just ask you a couple of things. If we could be respectful to each other, I don't mind if you boo me or if you yell at me. That's fine. That's part of the process. But ask your question. Let me answer the question. And try not to scream at each other. If you disagree with somebody who's asking a question, please be respectful of them and let them finish their question. And if you agree or disagree with my answer, be equally respectful. I'm going to try to do the same thing to you. And since we have so many people, I'm going to try to get through as many questions as possible. Anyway, without further ado, let's just go ahead and whoever has questions, let's get to the microphone.
I feel a tremendous responsibility, and as a father, I feel a tremendous responsibility to make sure that education is done well at the local level, and I will fight with you to make sure that good teachers are actually getting sufficient funds. I think part of the problem, we have a high level of administration, and sometimes the money's not coming down to the good teachers that are doing a good job, and that's what I want.
Thank you for your time.
Thank you. Let's go here.
Thank you for coming tonight, Congressman Lovejoy.
Thank you for being here.
So, both the IRS tax code, well, the IRS tax code indicates that there is no restriction for a person to release their taxes while under audit. The administration still clings to this excuse. Congress has the power to subpoena those, yet refuses to act. I'd like to understand if this is A, because they feel that the investigative committees and the public have no need to know about obligations President Trump has to foreign powers and belligerents, or that they are afraid of offending a Republican president, or that they're buying this excuse, or some other reason that I'd like you to explain, please.
Great question. I take it they're not clapping at me, so that's good. So it's really important. I want to take your second point really, really quickly, because you and I are going to agree and disagree all throughout the night on a lot of things. I have no problem challenging a president of the other party or a president of my party, and I think I've shown that in my 10 years in Washington, D.C. I have no problem challenging my leadership or the leadership of the other party. And so I just so you know, when you and I disagree on something, it's not because I'm afraid of challenging somebody. I don't think that there's anything in the law that requires the president to provide his tax returns. I think there's nothing in the law.
That's correct. However,
I didn't hear you.
That is correct.
However, there
are numerous questions here, and it has been
done. So let me continue. So I don't think there's anything in the law, and we as a body, our responsibility is to investigate if they have done something that is illegal. I don't think I can go forward and ask for his tax returns when I have no evidence of any crime that you're trying to find.
But we have
I can't hear.
We have active investigation. We have active investigations into possible links about a Russian link. While that's not a criminal indictment, it is indication of possible wrongdoing. Possible.
Yeah. And that's the problem. My job is, if you look at the history of investigative bodies in Washington, D.C., when Congress gets involved, it's when there's evidence of criminality, not when there's... That's usually what happens. Is when there's evidence of any wrongdoing. The CIA and the FBI have told us that they are investigating any potential collusion, but so far all the reports have told us that there's no evidence of collusion between the Trump administration. Okay. Thank you. Can you speak up a little bit?
Sure. I'm Charmaine Tanner. I live in your district. I'm not paid to be here.
You know, even if you were paid, you have a right to be here, right? So
I do have another question about education. As a parent, retired teacher, and now an advocate for students with disabilities, I want to make sure that our federal, state, and local governments ensure that all students get the education they deserve. I know we have many dedicated educators in our state. As a special education advocate, I travel throughout the state of Idaho and attend many school meetings with families. I see many teachers that care about children and are trying their best with what they know and what they have to meet the needs of students with disabilities. Unfortunately, I witness daily the inequities that exist for students with disabilities and their parents. There is a need in Idaho for more training for new and veteran teachers so they can be more successful teaching all students, especially those who are typically marginalized. Idaho has many additional education needs that have to be addressed. I don't see how the Trump proposed budget that will slash public education funding by $9 billion and instead fund more charter schools and private school vouchers, how that will be beneficial. Many citizens don't understand that although charter schools are public schools, they often discriminate against students with disabilities. Vouchers for private schools are also misunderstood by many parents and legislators. A voucher may only pay for part of the tuition cost, and parents of children with disabilities often find their children would never be accepted by a private school. For these reasons and more, charter schools and private schools, even with vouchers, aren't a realistic choice for many families. Can you commit to not voting for a budget that undermines public education and the federal rights that students with disabilities currently have?
So I agree with you. I think we have some wonderful teachers here in Idaho, and I think we need to take care of the needs of our students. One of the problems that we have with the federal program is that there's so many demands that they require at the local level, where some of the money is not going directly to the teachers and it's not going directly to the students. My vision for education is to make sure that we get rid of some of the mid-level management bureaucracy that is kind of siphoning off some of the money, and so we can put more money on the things that you want, the good teachers and the good students. So I agree with you. And I still think that the money should be sent to the, and I apologize if I'm repeating myself because it's the same question that was asked. I think we need to bring the accountability and the responsibility to the state level. But I agree with you. I want to see more of the money going to the classroom and less money going to administration.
Well, the problem is... I understand your support of state rights, but then we also have state responsibilities.
And I agree with you
100%. We know in Idaho that education is really co-dependent. So what's your position on vouchers?
So I in Idaho we can't do vouchers because of the state constitution. I do believe that there should be competition in the schools. But I also have a philosophy, and it's about government in general, not just about education. You know, I obviously believe in limited government. I believe that we should have a fair and effective government. But I also believe that whatever government has a responsibility, and education is one of those, we have it in our state constitution, we should be the best provider out there. So it's not just that we be limited, and that's one of the reasons we should have a limited government. We should be doing few things, but those things that we're doing, we should be doing them as well or better than anybody else. Thank you.
You've made your pro-life stance known, but I wonder why your position on other issues don't seem to support childbirth and parenthood. For example, you went on Morning Joe a few weeks ago and spoke out categorically against paid parental leave, and that's just one example. You seem very concerned about the well-being of children before they're born, but I wonder what happens to that compassion. But I wonder what happens to that compassion going forward in terms of the positive change you could make in the areas of healthcare and education and parental leave.
Great question. So I am pro-life, and I'm pro-life all the way. I believe that we have a responsibility to each other as a society, but the difference that you and I have is that sometimes some people want that responsibility to be the burden of the government. I think that should be the burden of the local communities. I think when people are in need, and I'll tell you my story. I was raised in a single parent home. My mom was I was her only child, and we didn't have anything when I was growing up. And we were lucky enough that we had the love that we needed in our home, and my mom had to work hard and to help provide for me. And we also had a good community, our church community, and friends and family that took care of each other. I think we need to stop relying so much on the government and start relying more on each other. And I don't want to be always telling businesses and individuals what they must do. That's not my job. My job is to make sure that we have an environment where you and your community, I mean, look at all these people that are here that are with you. You should all be taking care of each other. And instead of, that's what I want, is for all of us to take care of our society. I spend hours volunteering my time. My wife spends hours volunteering her time for her community. And I think that's what we should all do for each other. So it's not always the government that should be doing these things for us.
Then what are you doing for us?
I can't hear you.
I'm sorry, then what are you doing for us if you don't think government should help our lives?
Well, that's where you and I disagree on philosophy. You think that the government should provide everything. I don't.
It's no secret that the United States lags behind the rest of the Western world in terms of paid parental leave.
I'm sorry. Wait. When you guys scream in the middle of her question, I can't hear what she's saying on either microphone. So
it's no secret that the United States is lagging behind the rest of the Western world in terms of paid parental leave. So I don't understand why don't we strive for better?
We just disagree on this.
Why don't we strive for better and not just the status quo?
You think that's better? I don't think that's better. So
I think that's better also. On March 28, 2017, all four of Idaho's national representatives voted yes to allow internet service providers to sell our private data, including web browsing history, to advertisers and other companies without our consent. Mike Simpson was absent for the vote. He said he didn't understand what the question was for the vote. Collectively, you, Crapo, and Rich got $48,000 last year from the telecom industry. Why did you give Comcast, AT&T, and Verizon a legal right to spy on us for $48,000?
So this is a very good question. And
I know that.
And this bill, frankly, was a complicated bill that did... Are you going to give me an opportunity to answer the question? The bill came because of what happened last year under the Obama administration. The FCC and the FTC used to have separate roles in what happened with our privacy and with our data. Under the Obama administration, they decided to combine everything that the FCC and the FTC were doing into one agency. Unfortunately, the FTC was the agency that had the most experience protecting our privacy. So when they combined it under one place, it actually created a confusion that even the members of the board, both Republicans and Democrats of the FTC and the FCC, were concerned about the problems that it would cause for privacy. What this bill attempted to do is to go back to what it used to be. So nothing, to go back to having them under different agencies. So Google and agents and these private companies like Google are being taken care of under one agency that used to take care of them. And then service providers are being taken care of under a separate agency as they were being checked before. We actually had some really good privacy. We were checking on privacy and we were doing a good job before this combination. And you may be misunderstanding me. I'm not saying that the Obama administration did something bad. I'm just saying that they tried to combine something that created a problem that was unforeseen. So what this bill did is it separated back to what happened before the Obama administration so that the FTC and the FCC would work separately. Still to this day, most of these service providers do not sell your data. Google does. Google sells your data.
But you just made it legal.
No, we didn't. What we did is we sent it back to the way it used to be. So you can put it, so nothing changed from the way it used to be. Before the Obama administration put them in the same house, and they weren't selling your data, and they're not gonna sell your data now. That's not the intent of the legislation.
But it's legal to do it.
It is not legal to do it, and what they did is they separated, and they're gonna continue to check on, they're gonna check on each other, and they didn't do it before. We just went to what happened, the way the law was before it was combined by the Obama.
So bottom line, how does it help us?
How does that help you?
How does your vote towards this help us?
So the FTC that had all of the expertise on checking and protecting your privacy is now the agency that is checking on these ISPs. The FCC did not have that expertise. So I put it back into the agency that actually had the expertise that have been protecting your privacy in the past, and they're gonna continue to protect your privacy in the future. That's what we were trying to do.
The Journal of the American Medical Association. The Journal of the American Medical Association, most recent publication in April, identified vital directions for health and healthcare priorities. They ask a series of questions to the nation and its leaders. The first question they ask is, does this nation commit to basic health care as a human right denied to no one? The American Medical Association said that they believe health care is a human right. My question to you is, do you believe that health care is a basic human right that should not be denied to any U.S. citizen? If you believe healthcare is a basic human right, then how would you ensure that all Americans receive the healthcare they need? If you do not believe healthcare is a human right, then do you simply believe that only people who can afford to buy healthcare should get health care?
So no, I do not believe that health care is a basic right. When something is a right, and I think you described it in your question, is something that must be provided by the government. And I don't believe that healthcare should be provided by the government. So,
if you look at our ranking for healthcare outcomes.
But I do believe people should have access to healthcare.
Yeah, and I so, have access to buy a Mercedes.
I didn't hear what you said.
I have access to buy a Mercedes. I could go to a car dealer who sells Mercedes. The only problem is I can't afford a Mercedes. Many people can't afford decent health care if it is not provided by the government.
I think we should take care of vulnerable people. I think we should take care of people that cannot work, that cannot provide for themselves. I do think we have a responsibility for those people. But if you're a working person, if you're a person that can provide for yourself, I think we should make it easier and less expensive for you to receive health care. I think that's a responsibility.
How would you, sure that people who are minimum wage workers with one child or two children, a family of four, minimum wage, how do they get
minimum wage people for the most part rely on the Medicaid program, and I think the Medicaid program. And I do think we have, and if you look at the health, as you guys know, I opposed the health care bill that was presented in Washington. But one of the good things that the health care bill had, okay, so there were several things that I didn't like, but one of the good things that it had $100 billion to take care of that gap that you're talking about, the gap between Medicaid and those people who maybe are minimum wage who cannot afford Medicaid. That was one of the positive aspects of the bill. What we're trying to do is we're trying to create a system that reduces the cost of health insurance for all Americans. And we do want to help people that are vulnerable with that.
Seriously, guys, when you guys do that, I can't hear the question. So
you know, all of these policies were ushered in an environment smothered with xenophobia and a lot of racist behavior, which is true. So, consider, if you recently forwarded the bill, I think it was HR 25 something, it was about mobilizing ICE. Is that kind of the gist of it? Is that fair to say?
I'm not sure what bill you're talking about, but go ahead and keep going with your question.
All right. So considering that ICE is the main enforcer, taking, basically deporting folks, and knowing that reporting of crimes is going down in Latino communities, do you think this law is racially motivated and targets folks based on race? And do you think it's making communities safer if reporting of crimes is going down?
So first of all, you've mentioned that statement two or three times that reporting of crimes has gone down. We have seen no evidence for that. I'm not saying that it's not true, but I'm in the Judiciary Committee, and I asked a question because I serve on the Immigration Subcommittee. I'm the Vice Chair of the Immigration Subcommittee, and we have asked that question, and we have received no evidence that reporting has gone down. So just so you know, there's no evidence of that. So now to answer your bigger question, whether enforcing immigration law is xenophobic, no. If you're here illegally, you don't have a right to be in the United States. We have the responsibility in Congress to make sure that we fix the problems with the immigration system. So the first step that we need to do, and I've said this for a few years, we need to first start with enforcement. What you're seeing right now with the Trump administration is that enforcement is going on up, but also the number of people coming into the United States illegally is going down. Which is a good thing. When we start feeling like the enforcement is working, I do think that we have a responsibility also to reform or what I call modernize our immigration system. We need to figure out what to do. What are the kinds of people we want to come to the United States? Let's bring them to the United States if we need them in whatever capacity. And then the third step,
And some of my friends that actually agree with me on most things are going to disagree with me now. I do think we have to do something with the 12 million people that are here. We got to figure that out. But that, not until we fix the enforcement and the immigration system should we fix this, because we have a history, and it happened in 1985. In 1985, Ronald Reagan decided to grant amnesty to the 3 million people that were here illegally, and he was promised that if he granted the amnesty, we were going to fix the enforcement and the immigration system. And guess what happened? The amnesty was granted, but the other two steps never happened. And what we created was a system that went from 3 million people to 12 to 20 million people. What I want to do is I want to fix the entire immigration system so we can bring the people to the United States which we need in the United States, so we can have fairness. But to me, when I'm looking at the immigration system, the number one priority is it fair to U.S. citizens and the American people? This is something that actually protects the citizens of the United States. And I think we can do it, and I think we can fix it. But anyway, thank you for your question.
Hi. Thank you for coming tonight. I appreciate you. Director for the Idaho Gem Society here in Boise. I also represent the Northwest Federation Mineralogical Society, which we are a part of. It includes all of the Northwest, including Alaska. And we also are part of the American Federation, okay? In Idaho, the environmental impact statement, the draft for the proposed sagebrush focal area withdrawal is badly.
Did you say sagebrush?
For the sagebrush focal area withdrawal.
Okay.
It's bad news for our recreational rock hounding, and that's because what the BLM wants to do, intends to do, is to ban the use of shovels and other hand tools for rock hounding in withdrawn areas. The draft is protecting the greater sage-grouse area. It also includes 10 million acres, 3 million in Idaho, okay? To help the sage grouse, you don't need 3 million acres taken away from us. And it's being taken away because what's happening there for the next 20 years, that's what they're putting in it, that we cannot do this on these 3 million acres. Okay? But now, on page 1 and 2 of the proposal, of the draft, if approved, it wouldn't prohibit the authorized uses of grazing, recreation, off-highway vehicle use. But unfortunately, recreational rock hounding in Idaho comes under the 1872 Mining Act, okay? So it's considered causal use under the mining law. And the causal use goes away, leaving the BLM free to do whatever it wants in that regard. So what can you do for us, for the recreational rock hounders in Idaho? The only thing that looks feasible to us is that they would add to this statement recreational rock hounding.
Okay, so thank you for the question. I have to admit, it's the first time I hear it. So the recreational rock hounding aspect of it, we've been dealing with the sagebrush issue now for a long time, and we're working in our committee of natural resources to make sure that we can work with the BLM and we can work with all the different agencies.
And we as a group work with the BLM also.
So,
work with them.
I have my staff here. I have not heard about the issue, so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna make sure that hopefully they can get your name and number.
Okay.
And we can try to do a little bit of research, because it would be inappropriate for me to try to answer the question, because it's the first time that I have heard of it.
Thank you.
All right, thank you very much.
Hi, my name's Jeff. I'm 75 years old. I've never missed an election. School board winning. I've never missed an election. I almost missed the last one. My sister called me up and she said, "Jeff, we don't have anybody to vote for." And I said, "No, both these parties screwed us." And that's the way I felt. I did vote, but I voted against someone instead of for someone. I put that on your party and the other party. They did a disgrace to this nation. by putting some people in there that have terrible backup, I honestly believe. I came to talk about two things that affected me and my family drastically, that George Bush, either in his executive orders or his appointments to his cabinet. The first is the EPA. We need government intervention because I live in L.A. California.
California, okay.
Yeah, I live
there. I was like, what city?
I'm new to Idaho. I came here in January. I come from Arizona.
Welcome.
Thank you. The thing that discouraged me is with the EPA, I live in a small, polluted, not just the air, but everything was polluted. The ground was polluted. The rivers were polluted. And the state of California actually went above the Washington, D.C. and started doing something about it. He's put somebody in office that you approved that is against the EPA. And we definitely need Years ago, I was like you. I wanted limited government. And I was a young, you know, Republican and the whole job. I stopped being a Republican after George Bush. But I still vote for Republicans, both senators in Arizona, they have my full support. But I want you to know, we don't fix things without some kind of authority getting behind it and cracking the whip. And we haven't. We haven't had the history that does it, and it hasn't happened. I worked in Riverside County before I was transferred here, or before I was transferred to Arizona. And in that block, there was a great big mall called Tyler Mall in Riverside. And I lived worked right across the street from it. 100 days a year minimum, you couldn't see it. Huge mountain ranges that went up over 10,000 feet, both to the north and to the east. You might have saw about 150 days out of 360. That's how thick it was in 74. It just didn't happen by itself. They're eliminating emissions, they're eliminating how many miles a car can go with, you know, they want to drop that. I don't see where that's for the betterment of the common good. It's for somebody like the car manufacturers, the oil guys. It's not for us. It's about time they started protecting us.
You had a lot in there, so I'm going to try to answer most of it, okay? First, your initial comment, I don't necessarily disagree with it, which is I think both parties have let us down in many different ways. So the problem in Washington, D.C., and sometimes at the state level, but it's a bigger problem in Washington, D.C., is that, in my opinion sometimes, what you have is one party likes big government, the other party likes big business, and they both collude, and they don't take care of the little guy. So I agree with you 100%. And we need to make sure that government is actually looking out for the little guy and not looking out just for big special interests. So you and I agree on that. So now going back to the EPA. If you go to North Idaho, for example, there's a lot of good things that the EPA has done. If you look at the history of mining in Idaho and some things, we did have some rivers that were polluted. We had some things that were not pristine. And the EPA has done some good things in Idaho and, as you're saying, in some other areas. The problem that we have is that the EPA has gotten to a point where there's some excess in the things that they're doing. So what we're trying to do is we're trying to bring them back to what their original mission is, which you and I seem to agree on, which is we want to have clean air, clean water, and all those different things. But what we don't want is the EPA to be such a burden to the development of society
that they're making it more difficult for us to do this.
Okay, but I appreciate your honesty. Right. One other thing. I don't want anybody to bring it up. And that's about the deregulation of the banking system. It cost me and my family $350,000 in 2008. I'm 75. I never made that up. No one went to prison. No one even went to court.
Well,
how can you live with that?
I wasn't in Congress with that. When I talk about big government and big business, one of the problems that we have is that regulations. For example, we created government entities to try to prevent banks that were too big to fail. And what we're creating is we're taking out the little banks out, and the big banks are actually thriving right now. So we always have to be careful what the unintended consequences of legislation are, because I think a lot of people were left behind. And I was against the bank bailouts. Even though I wasn't in Congress, I was against the bank bailouts because I think they were protecting the people that got us in trouble and not protecting the people that suffered.
Hi, I'm
Sunny
With all due respect, I have to say that to suggest that one party is all about big business and one party is all about big government is the type of polarizing comment that this system does not need right now. Pardon?
What's the last sentence?
It's a polarizing comment that I don't think benefits our country. Alright, so this is what I would like to speak about. You strike me as a politician who has a deep respect for the Constitution and the democracy that our founding fathers created. I agree with you on that. Our founding fathers created a brilliant system of checks and balances so that not one single arm of the government can take too much power and destroy our democracy. Our founding fathers also created a Constitution that was designed to handle a demagogue like Trump. What our founding fathers never imagined was that the legislative branch would completely acquiesce to the executive branch as it is doing today. Republican, and I need you to protect our democracy above all else. By doing your constitutional duty and holding Trump and the executive branch accountable. This means I want you to do your job and demand that Trump release his tax returns as every We need to know who he is indebted to for our national security interests. We need to know about his business interests, some, by the way, which he is not divested, because he may be making economic policy to benefit his own pocketbook. To investigate his ties to Russia. I need you to do your constitutional duty to pressure him to be more transparent, not less. To allow all press to cover White House briefings, not just those that support his viewpoint. To make visit logs public knowledge so that we know if he's hiring lobbyists he said he isn't going to hire. I need you to do your job to call out Trump and his administration on their blatant lies. I need you to stand up to
We do have to be respectful to each other. Look at the line behind you.
I agree.
Could you please just ask a question?
Yes, I will collaborate. Senator, I need you to perform your constitutional duty and be a check to our president. I have no doubt that if our president right now is a Democrat and had done all these things, you and all Republicans would be screaming at the top of your lungs about how wrong this is. And I feel like now, the shoe's on the other foot, and you are not performing your check and balance constitutional duty. So I would like to know, as a person who believes in the Constitution and the democracy that our founding fathers created, what are you going to do to prevent our democracy from going down this ugly, slippery slope into autocracy? Please, let us know how you're going to stop this.
So I'm going to do the same things that I did under President Obama. I'm going to make sure that we hold them accountable, that we hold the executive accountable. And I'll tell you, 2 years ago, 1 year ago, the shoe was in the other foot. I would go to town hall meetings, and I would have Republicans who voted for me screaming at me, why didn't you impeach Obama? Why didn't you do all these different things? And I would tell them the same thing that I'm going to tell you right now, that unless there's evidence of any criminality, I'm not going to go after a witch hunt after this president or the other president. There is an investigation right now in the Intelligence Committee. There's two committees that are investigating this. And we did not, for example, Benghazi did not become a joint committee. It did not become a joint committee and a large committee until there was evidence that there was some wrongdoing. So far, there's been no evidence of wrongdoing.
There's
a lot of allegations of wrongdoing, but there's no evidence. But I will continue to hold this president accountable just like I held the previous president.
I am a Republican, and I would like to know what you are actually doing to hold him accountable. No answer?
I answered your question.
I'm sorry, sir. You did not answer my question.
Thank you, Congressman. My question will be a lot shorter than it was because she stole most of my thunder.
Okay.
I actually wanted to first of all say I probably am on the other side of the spectrum from you. I respect your honesty. I respect that you believe in limited government and that you believe that some things like health care are the responsibility of people. Well, if you're going to have limited government and you're going to have not have government not take care of everything, I think one thing we must have is transparency. And we do not have transparency. The previous speaker talked about several things. I'll point out a couple more. The president only speaks to Fox News. He's on every day, he's not on any other networks. Mar-a-Lago, as far as I can tell, has become a black site to meet businessmen outside of the purview of the press. That it should be unconstitutional. And even if these things aren't particularly strictly illegal, if you're a good moral person, you should be fighting for more transparency for that. I think that some of the people in the government now, specifically EPA, are lying. They're saying they're there to reform it. Pruitt absolutely said he was there to destroy it. Just like you want to destroy education, at least you're honest enough to say it.
You say you are going to destroy
education. You can't answer Department of Education.
I never said that I wanted to destroy education. Those were your words.
No, the Department. Excuse me, Department.
Okay, thank you.
The Department, the EPA Department. Okay. Department of Education.
And I don't want to destroy it. I want the states to take care of education.
Yeah. So I would like to see, along with taxes,
you want to see with
taxes being transparent, visitor logs, emoluments clause issues, and I don't know how much of that you can do in legislation in the Republican Party, but if you are the good moral person that you say you are, I think it's your moral responsibility to address these issues.
I do think there should be more disclosure. I actually think there should always be disclosure. I think the more sunlight there is in on any issue, that's important. I think that we should have more access to records of any administration. But I'm talking about the administration. I'm talking about the things that they're doing.
You can co-sponsor legislation with Democrats and get that done.
I also think we need to... You know, there's some things that the White House is doing that I don't like and you don't like, and I think that we need to improve those things. But we also need to make sure that we don't go down a path that everything that somebody does... I didn't always complain about everything that President Obama did. There were some things that it's true, I actually worked with the President. I went to the White House probably more than any other, than most Republicans, to work with the President on criminal justice reform, on immigration, and other things that I agreed with the President. So I think we should work together, and I agree with you, and I think there should be more transparency. I just think this is really good. Speak into the microphone so everybody can hear you.
On the topic of family, you recently quoted saying, is she up to the individual business person who decided that? So you obviously oppose regulations on enforcing that. My question is, do you support rules and regulations requiring them to be transparent about that to their potential employees and their consumer base?
I guess I'm not understanding the question. What do you mean being transparent about?
About whether or not they provide family leave.
Oh, I see. Well, I don't think that we should provide, that we should require businesses to do that, but I think you as a consumer should ask your businesses where you do business. I used to provide family leave, not all to my employees. I do now as an employer, as a congressman as well. You should ask the businesses that you go to, but this is again the fundamental difference that we have, where you want the government to demand certain things of people and businesses, and I want less of that. So I think it's your responsibility to go to your local businesses and say, to me it's really important that you provide family leave for your employees. Do you do it or not? And then you can make a basic decision as a consumer. I don't think it's the government's responsibility to do that. I'm sorry that I'm going back and forth. I can't stand in the middle because that light is right in my eye. So,
Art Collins.
Hi, Art.
After today, when are you coming to the... That's two questions. After today, when are you coming to the great state of Northern Idaho? First question. And the second question is, would you lobby for and insist on the following, that a revision of the ACA or the repeal of the ACA would include incentives to be well. In other words, that there would be provisions to reward now, people who don't use the health care policy because they're well.
Thank you. a great question. First, your first question. We are going up to North Idaho. I don't know exactly the date, but it's going to be in the next few weeks. We're going to do a few more town hall meetings. We're doing one in Nampa on Monday, so we're trying to get around the whole district. So yes, we're going to go up to the great state of North Idaho. So,
I'll be there and ask the same question.
All right. So now your question about wellness. It's an important question, and what we're trying to do, we need to, I don't know that I want the government requiring wellness per se, a wellness program, but
I said incentives.
But the incentive, this is one of the fights we're having. So let me explain a little bit about this. So the ACA right now treats everybody the same regardless of their health. So if you're of the same age group, if you're a healthy young person or a less healthy young person, the ACA requires that the insurance companies charge you exactly the same amount of money. I don't think that's fair. I think that is not how insurance works. That's actually the opposite of insurance. The way insurance is supposed to work is if you're healthy, you're going to get one rate. If you're a little bit less healthy, you're going to get another rate. So what you're asking for is what all these people are against, which is that they don't want different ratings for age, for health, and different things. So what we're trying to accomplish with the repeal of the ACA is, in my opinion, we need to make sure that we don't have those requirements so health insurance premiums come down for most Americans. But there's going to be a group of people that their premiums are going to go up. So we need to make sure that we have the subsidies so we can help those people so they can pay for their health insurance. So I want you to be rewarded for being healthy, and the people that are maybe less healthy, we can subsidize their premiums.
In other words, you want to include provisions to reward people to be healthy,
insurance,
and not use the plan. They don't use the plan because they're healthy. And I'm saying is, how can you provide and reward those people for being healthy?
And the way you reward them is by the way you rate the different plans. If you're a healthy person, you pay less for your plan. And the way you do that is by getting rid of the regulations that Obamacare had in place.
Hello, my name is Steve Messenger, and I ask you to have patience with my statements, my voice, my delivery. I have a disease of the type that our president openly mocked on national TV. We had a budget introduced by our president, who claims to be the president for everybody, that would eliminate almost anything that enriched our lives. allies and double down on the military, which we obviously don't need. We have far more weapons than we could ever use. My question relates back to this Mar-a-Lago thing, because it hasn't been mentioned yet. You mentioned that he's going down every weekend, even though he criticized the president for doing about 1/4 as often. But the money goes to him, because the Secret Service and all the people have to pay Mar-a-Lago, which he owns. So he's putting our taxpayer money in his own pocket. His wife, whether she, I don't know if this is a woman, she doesn't want to live with him, or...
I didn't hear that last.
His wife is not living with him. I don't know why, we can all speculate. Her claim is that her son doesn't want to be taken out of elementary school. We have military families that were transferred year after year after year, and he can't sacrifice for his son in Washington. So we pay over $150,000 taxpayer dollars a day to protect his, again, going to Trump Towers, a lot of it. Money in his own pocket. How can you say that's ethical?
Thank you for your question. I'm going to separate the two questions that you asked. The first question is going down to Mar-a-Lago. I actually agree with you. I think we need to be a little bit careful. I think the most important thing is that the president needs to understand that there's people like you who have needs, who are suffering with things, and we're spending taxpayer money on those trips every single week.
I don't need money, I need respect. Yeah.
I thought I was provided this, so I apologize. So, I didn't say that it was about money. I said that we have people that have needs and whatever those needs are. So the second issue is a little different. You do have a child that is finishing his school year. My understanding, the way I have read the news report, is that as soon as he's done with his school year, they're going to be moving into the White House. So I see those as two separate issues, and I think that, but I do think we should be careful. And the president should think about what he's doing with his
what I want you to say is, you don't think it's an open conflict of interest for the president to direct taxpayer money directly into his own pocket.
You know, I don't know exactly, I don't know what his relationship is with Mar-a-Lago anymore.
For anyone if it raised the deficit and the national debt?
Great question. Great question. So we have to look at tax reform, and I think you're asking a very excellent question. We need to look at tax reform in a way that does not increase the debt and the deficit. So we right now have a $20 trillion debt. And I have always advocated for tax reform that was going to increase the revenues that we were going to bring, not necessarily always decrease the revenues, but to do it in a way that would actually create a system that brings about economic growth and those things that are better for the community. So as I'm looking at whatever tax bill comes before Congress, I do think that we have to look at some, at making sure that we're not necessarily increasing the national debt, that we're looking at economic growth and ways for us to bring more revenues in different ways. So thank you for your question.
I want to start by, again, thanking you for putting yourself out here in front of your constituents. It doesn't look like much fun.
I actually like it, you know. I'm used to getting booed. I get it at home all the time.
So as background, I'm a political centrist. I've voted in my past Democratic and Republican. I'm mostly interested in good governance and solutions. So my question will be related to governance and competence. You're now in control, you being a Republican, are now in control of the Congress and the executive branch. In my view, in the first 100 days, the Republican Congress appears fully unprepared to govern, as was made obvious by the horrible bill that was the AHCA. That was a legislation that spoke for speed and political expediency. Okay, I understand why you opposed it. I do too, and 83% of the population did. However,
it was a popular bill.
you're a founding member of the House Freedom Caucus, is that correct?
Correct.
And it seems to me that your caucus has had a lot of practice saying no, including on the AHCA. So going forward, I don't see how the Republicans are ever going to pass any kind of legislation around health care, tax reform, infrastructure, or any other agenda item if they don't develop a governing coalition. Governing is a messy process of finding a compromise in the middle. Ideologues are well suited to be backbenchers and out of power. You're not out of power anymore. And I don't want to hear any more about Obama and Hillary and all that. You guys are it's on you now to bring the people of this country and all the people in this country progress and solutions. So, question. One of your colleagues, I think it's Tim Poe.
Ted Poe.
Yeah. Resigned from the House Freedom Caucus recently. I assume moving to the middle. Will you move to the middle and work with fellow Republicans and more moderate Democrats to move this country forward? And if not, what's your vision for a government coalition?
Great question. That's a great question. And I think you and I actually agree more than you think. The problem with the legislative process, I'm going to compare two different legislatures that I have served in, okay? I served in the Idaho legislature, and I've now served in Congress. The Idaho legislature works really well in the way that they work their process. I'm talking about process, not results. So I agree with the results of the Idaho legislature, most of you disagree. But the process actually works. And the way I envision our founding fathers envisioned the process to work is that you were supposed to represent your individual states and your individual congressional districts. And my job is to represent my district the way that I told my constituents I was going to represent them. But I'm one of 435, right? So I can't always get my way as being one of 435. So if you let the legislative process work, what eventually happens is that the process becomes more centrist. So follow what I'm saying. So I'm a very conservative Republican, right? So as a very conservative Republican, I'm going to push the legislation to the right. If we let amendments work the way they're supposed to work in committee, I'm not the only member of Congress in that committee. Some of my amendments are going to pass. Some more centrist amendments are going to pass, right? And then you're going to see that the final bill will be something that is more representative of the people, of the American people as a whole. Some of that legislation I'm going to vote for, even though I'm going to have to hold my nose a little bit because I don't like certain parts of it. But it went through the legislative process, and it reflected the body in its entirety. Right now, what we have in Congress is a system that the leadership determines what the end result should be. You as a centrist should be as unhappy as I am as a conservative with that, because your views are not being represented, and my views are not being represented. Do you understand what I'm saying? So if we actually go back to the way our founding fathers intended Congress to be, most legislation will be somewhere in that sweet spot where the American people are. But right now what I get is I'm told by my leadership that I have to vote for this because it's a binary choice, you either take it or leave it. And I say, no, I actually would like to improve that bill a little bit. I would like to have some things passed in, you know, it be included in that bill that actually makes it something that I can vote for. Yes, I'm still going to hold my nose on a couple of things,
but I can vote for that. So where you're being, and this is why I said something earlier that you guys were booed about, which I didn't understand why, is that both parties are at fault because we have allowed the leadership to determine what the ultimate outcome is instead of letting the legislative body and the legislative process. So, as a citizen, you should be standing with me in the Freedom Caucus. Because the Freedom Caucus, when we created the Freedom Caucus, what we created was, our main concern was the process, was that we were not being allowed to offer the amendments and the changes and the and participate in the process as representatives of the United States. And in fact, when we decided that we didn't want Boehner to be the speaker anymore, the person that we, and I think the people, most Americans didn't understand it, the person that we wanted to be the Speaker of the House, his name was Daniel Webster, who is a centrist. He wasn't the most conservative member of the House. He was actually a centrist. But why did we want Daniel Webster to be the Speaker of the House? First, because he's got an awesome name, right? Daniel Webster. But second, because he had run the Florida legislature. He was the Speaker of the House in Florida, and he was the majority leader of the Senate in Florida, so he filled both jobs, and he ran the legislative body the way that we think the Founding Fathers intended it to be. So you and I agree, even though we may disagree on what we want the final outcome to be. But thank you very much.
Thank you.
I think that should be investigated and prosecuted. But there's no by the FBI, of course. So that needs to be investigated. But there is no evidence. The committee, and they have come to us again and again and again and have told us that there's evidence of collusion. You guys need to distinguish between collusion, I mean evidence of interference, not collusion. The interference comes from the Russians. They tried to interfere in our election. They do it all the time. That's what's amazing about this, is that they have done it in the past. They interfered last year with the elections in several other countries. They do it all the time. The question that we need to be concerned about is whether the Trump team colluded with them. He was investigated by the FBI, and they found no evidence of collusion yet. I'm not saying that they're not going to find any. And if they find it, then they should be prosecuted. I agree with you 100%.
Okay, back to nepotism.
I think. Read the first line of the nepotism.
A public official may not appoint, employ, promote, advance, or advocate for appointment, employment, promotion, or advancement in or to a civilian position in an agency, which is what Ivanka Trump is holding, in which he is serving over or which he exercises jurisdiction or control, any individual who is a relative of the public official.
No, I heard all the White House is not an agency, number one. So, but there are anti-nepotism laws that apply. I don't think that one
For the
does.
Purpose of this section, agency means, quote, an executive agency.
Yeah, agency. The White House is not an agency. But there are anti-nepotism laws. I don't think this one applies to the White House.
Okay.
It's not an agency.
We'll be writing a letter from
and
New York
we need to look at that.
U.S. Code 3110. We can hopefully I get more
that,
than
that. That law does not. That particular law does not apply to the White House. But there are other laws that apply to the White House, and I think they need to make sure that they're following.
Thank you very much.
That's your job. That's your job.
I am doing my job.
Randy Nelson.
Hold on, guys. I can't hear.
My name is Randy Nelson. I'm a Medicaid participant. I had to retire about 5 years ago. And when I did my premiums before I retired, when I was working, I was on Medicaid and working for about $150 a month.
You were on Medicaid?
I was on Medicaid and working.
Medicaid
for workers with disability. Yeah. When I retired, my premium went to $2,200 a month. Basically, it's because I had a decent job, and under the current federal program, it's not the state of Idaho. The calculation of what I pay for my share of costs says they take my total income and they say, we'll let you live on this little bit amount of money, and then we're gonna take the rest of it. So I made $5,000 in retirement, and they only allow
you
to
live on. I'm sorry, $5,000 per year?
Per month.
Per month, okay.
And they only let you keep enough money to pay your rent or your mortgage, and then they take the rest of it. That's why now it's $2,400 a month, starting last month. I think the whole system needs to be revised, and you're gonna tell me it's a state problem, but it's actually a federal program, and it needs to be calculated different. And it deals with people with disability, and elderly people that need to have in-home care in their homes. Otherwise, you have to go to a nursing home, which nobody wants to do. So it's something that needs to be done at the federal level. There are states, every state has a thing called a personal needs allowance. That's the amount of money you get to keep. But it should be more uniform between the states, because these people in the Idaho legislature, they're so tight that they don't let you keep part of your retirement money that you earn. I've worked for 26 years.
Thank you. So, so So if I'm hearing you correctly, you have some state issues and also federal issues. Is that, did I hear that? That the program is actually run through the state, but it's a federal program. Did I hear that correctly?
It's Medicaid.
It's correct.
State and federal.
Well, okay. So, I hope you don't think I'm cute if this is a cop-out, but it sounds like a pretty complicated issue, and this actually gives me an opportunity to tell all of you, whether you agree with me politically or not, we have some of the most dedicated staffers in my office who deal with these cases. And what I would invite you to do, I'm going to have one of my staffers give you our...
I wrote you a letter and said, it's a state problem.
So then we need to deal with it legislatively. So I want to come, I want to make sure that somebody meets with you so we can look at exactly what the state is doing and what the federal programs are doing, so we can talk to you about whether there's something that we can do under the current program, which it sounds like there's not, or whether what we need to do is the legislative fix to the problem that you're having. And I would love to have my staff
Okay.
So I just want to ask somebody to sit down with you and talk about it, if that would be okay.
Okay.
All right. Thank you very much.
My name is Anita McNeil, and I represent the widows of veterans. We have a bill trying to get through. I have asked you for over 6 years, every year, since I talked to Tory 6 years ago, to co-sponsor. That bill was not supposed to ever exist. In 2004, when the veterans got their concurrent receipt, one of the reasons why is they dropped the issue of SPP and DIC. The widows have been fighting for 13 years. Now, this has nothing to do with Trump or the education. It has to do with widows of veterans who did not get the opportunity.
Can you explain the issue a little bit more?
Yeah. First off, it is H.R. 846.
Okay.
This has to do with SPP, which is survivor benefits, and DIC, which is the compensation for the veterans.
And what is the issue that you're having?
The issue is we're trying to get rid of every dollar that VA gives us. They take away the dollar from SPP. One is an annuity, the other one's a compensation. Both are not the same. We paid in $165 every month for 25 years into SPP. And for every dollar I have paid in, they've taken away because of compensation. Now, we're trying to do the same thing for the widows as the veterans got with concurrent receipt. For every dollar they had taken away from their retirement, because for the dollar they received in VA disability.
Okay.
The only thing I'm here to ask for, and I've asked you for 6 years, is to help be a co-sponsor from Idaho. Simpson has got on board, Craco has got on board, and I'm asking you.
Okay.
I've tried doing it through email, I've tried doing it through Tori. The only way I can do it is face to face.
So this is what I'll promise you too. Tomorrow I'll sit down with Tori and I'll look at the bill and we'll give you an answer. Okay?
The only answer I want is the co-sponsor. And that form letter is identical to Senator Rich. That if this bill comes to the floor, that you will look at it. Congressman Labrador, unless we have enough co-sponsors, will never get to
the
floor.
I will look at it, and by Friday, I will get you an answer. Okay? Thank you. Totally fine. Just make sure you speak into the microphone.
Yeah, please. So,
that's a great t-shirt, by the way.
Oh, yeah, thank you. Put it over the side afterwards. So anyway, First off, since this is heavily canceled politics, let's start with a joke. It's hard to explain the concept of kleptomaniacs because they always take things literally. Now, good on communications is probably another thing called a trigger warning, which is simply a verbal warning for a video, anything like that, that tells you, hey, there's some stuff that might get you riled up. So, to everyone who kindly is more right, this is a trigger warning because I'm going to talk about Black Lives Matter.
When you speak and they're clapping, I can't hear you.
So anyway, a good friend of mine was actually killed by a police officer a couple weeks ago. Death is a natural thing and it happens, unfortunately. Not by natural causes, by any baby, but by a man who, for some reason, felt like he was a threat to a woman, decided to shoot. That's unfortunate. But, one of the things I have for you is, what's your view for police reform? Like, police body cameras, investigations in police, like whether or not it should be internal or external. And because most recently, not even for Black people, but for Caucasians, Latinos, Asians, and Indian Americans, a lot of people don't know if that means, sir, but okay. There was a last man here in Idaho, I forgot what his name was, I believe that's what? Jack Yankis. Yes, he was murdered by cops because they tried to kill all his animals and didn't let him kill it himself. And, you know, I have choice words for that, but there's children and older people, and there's a professional thing about that, but it involves the F word and a couple other experts. So I want to know, though, what is your views on police reform, and how do you plan on making it not just right for us in Idaho, because aside from that unfortunate incident, we don't really have that much, but elsewhere, in your representative, you're speaking for, I could safely say all of us cares about accountability to the police because love or hate it, we all believe in the whole and good right and all that stuff. So what is your views on it?
Okay, so great question. I love the police. I think they do a great job to protect our community. But I think in any agency you're gonna have abuses and you're gonna have problems. So one of the things that I'm a big proponent of is having body cameras. And I think it's because it's good for the police and also the people that they're arresting. If you have a body camera, you can see what's happening and it gives you a better idea of what's going on. So I've always been a big proponent of body cameras.
All right.
I also happen to be, I call myself a conservative with libertarian leanings. I've been a big advocate of criminal justice reform. I've been a big advocate of making sure that we reform the way that we use our criminal justice system. So I think you and I may agree on some things and may disagree on some things, but I do believe that we need to make sure that we give the resources to the police, that we protect them, because I believe Black Lives Matter, I also believe that Blue Lives Matter, and I believe that White Lives Matter, that all Americans matter, and we need to make sure as a government that when we're giving people the power of arrest, the power of other people, that we're also holding them responsible for the actions that they take.
Okay. So, like you're used for like for-profit policing as well as demilitarization, are you?
I'll answer your question. I'll answer your question. So, I'm not a big proponent of private prisons. Security of our people, we should do it well, and we should do it with responsibility.
Are you already running next term?
That's a good question. Let's go right here. I
just want to say I do agree Black Lives Do Matter. That's a very important question. So. And I'd also like to thank you for holding this town hall.
Absolutely.
I really appreciate it. So my name is Cynthia
graduate student who relies on Planned Parenthood for affordable birth control so that I may be successful in my higher education. So why are you trying to degrade my care by defunding Planned Parenthood when I receive preventative medical care?
I think what you need to understand is that I don't want to take away anything from you. If you look at, if you want to, this is the state of Idaho. Those three yellow dots are Planned Parenthood facilities in the state of Idaho.
Yes, two in Treasure Valley, one in Boston.
Correct. These dots over here are federally qualified health clinics in the state of Idaho. What I want to do is I want to change, move the money from Planned Parenthood to these families.
Their utility rates would be unaffordable, and these projects simply wouldn't happen. And what that could lead to is essentially infrastructure failure and really kind of putting rural Idaho out of business. So the question I have for you is, what steps are you taking to protect the USDA Rural Development Program that really supports providing these basic utility services for our rural communities?
It's a great program, and we have supported it through legislation, through the funding mechanisms in Congress, and I will continue to support those programs. Thank you.
Hi, thank you again for being here.
Absolutely.
My name is Brooke, and I'm just kind of going to go off a little bit off of what the young woman before you, Michaela, said, because I don't think that there was really a sufficient answer. So you stated earlier, and you stated multiple times that you are for limited government and regulation. Given this view, how do you justify regulating women's bodies by coming between them and their doctors for restricting access to birth control, STI testing, and family services that only Planned Parenthood has the capacity to provide? And I don't really want to see that graph again, because that includes things like chiropractors' offices, dentist offices, and school counselors that do not have the responsibility and the capabilities that Planned Parenthood has. So how do you justify limited government when you are attempting to regulate women's bodies?
I don't believe that the federal government should be giving money to an abortion provider.
So
I want your health care needs to be taken care of, and we have facilities that take care of, and I want to even give the funding to those facilities.
Awesome.
I just don't think that they should be providing
an abortion. And you're pro-life, correct?
I am pro-life.
So pro-life, how do you justify defunding cancer screenings for millions of women across the country and thousands of women in Idaho?
there are other providers that provide the same cancer. That's good. It's a long night. Let me grab some water.
Get some water.
Yes.
Take a breath. We all can use a little.
Yes. Good. I agree.
All right. So, Congressman Labrador, I am Lori Warren. And we have lived here for the last 25 years in Idaho. We have moved to Boise just in the last couple of years. But for the last 20 years, I have actually been an independent college admissions financial aid coach to the kids here in Boise, and Idaho, and really truly across the United States. But most of my kids are here. Yes, I'm going back to the Department of Ed. I have some questions for you because I want to make certain that either A, you understand what you're doing, or B, I understand what you're doing. Okay? So, your desire to defund the Department of Education.
Correct.
Okay. This would make sense if we lived in Boston or in Massachusetts, where our education that we were giving to the kids in the state was in the top 10 of the United States. Do you know where we're ranked across the nation, education-wise?
Well, in funding, we're ranked 49. In actual performance, we're actually in the 20s. So, in performance in the state of Idaho, we're actually in the 20s. We actually do more with our tax monies than most of the
other states. Let me fix that. Yeah, what absolutely. I meant to say is, for the kids that are going on to higher education,
yeah,
we are ranked where? 48.
In performance, yes, I agree with you. Okay. Yes.
I have a three-part question for you. So part one is, where we are ranked 48 and already failing our kids on getting them to go on, why would you want to be part of this disastrous bill in the first place? That's question one. Question two is, I understand you also want to change the Department of Education from being the loan maker on student loans and go back to the system where we had banks being over. And I've seen both. I know, and I keep my kids in my practice knowing what's a good loan, what's a bad loan. Kids who are not exposed to someone like me don't know that they can go down the bank or down the street to a bank and get a student loan at 15% interest versus less than 4 from the Department of Education. Mm-hmm. So my question is, the third part is, really and truly, if you believe in the kids here in the state, which by the way, all of you constituents should know, our big employers are no longer hiring from our state. They go out of the state to get their best employees because they can't find.
I agree with you.
And I have been told this directly by them.
Me too.
So you are here to help to do a good job for us. So why would you spend or waste your time and our money on such a frivolous bill?
So first, it's not frivolous. The Department of Education, I think, is not doing the job that it was intended to do. I think we can do a better job at the state level. I don't disagree with you.
But
we do a pretty good job. We need to do better. And you and I agree on that. Being in the 20s is not a good thing. Being in the 20s is not a good thing. Being 48 in having students go to college is not a good thing. And the thing that affects me the most, I have 5 children, that they're gonna find better jobs outside of the state. I want them to come back to the state after they graduate
and
from college.
Because our biggest employers, the INL, Micron,
so
HP,
so
goes
is,
out of the state
that's why
to
we need
find
to reform,
their employees.
We need to reform the education system here.
that the education system in Idaho can actually give us better results. Because everything that you're saying is happening under the current Department of Education. So I want to fix it. So it's happening under the current department. I want to fix it. So we, as a state, take the responsibility to be in the top 10 in all of those areas that we want to be. And I want to help you with that. But I don't think it happens at the federal level. And in fact, the fact that we have all these problems shows that the federal government is not doing the job that we need to do.
That these other countries are educating their students for college. They go directly to university. It is paid for by the government. So
I understand, but they also, if you remember, in most of those countries, they separate people from trade school and college, and they have a totally different system that we do, where not everybody's encouraged to move on to college.
Hi. So I want to preface this.
Yeah, it is. Just speak really loudly.
Sure. Okay, so I want to preface this by saying that I think of myself as a pretty traditional guy. I come from a traditional household. I'm the primary breadwinner. I know my wife stays at home and takes care of her two young children. But I want to know why you think it's okay that my employer should be able to fire me just because I'm a lesbian.
Says is that the federal government should not take any...
So you just think I should be protected from being fired because I'm a lesbian?
No. Well, what I'm saying is that the First Amendment Protect Defense Act says that there's a First Amendment, and the First Amendment, the first part of the First Amendment is religious freedom. And I believe that we have a history and a tradition of religious freedom. There are people who have certain religious beliefs that are different than your religious
beliefs. And what about the right to pursue property?
You can have a right to pursue property. There's nothing in my bill that takes away your rights in any way. What
so
my
you
bill,
just don't want to protect vulnerable populations like myself.
What I believe is that the government should protect people, the rights that are in the Constitution, and the First Amendment is the first right that we have.
And you don't think freedom of my expression as being a lesbian?
You have all the rights that you have a right to express
I'm
yourself.
I'm not to be protected on the basis of that.
You are protected.
By whom?
You're protected, you have free speech, you have all the rights that are in the Constitution. I just think
so
that...
Who's enforcing that for me?
Are you here speaking?
Sure.
Yeah, so you have a right to express yourself. And you have... So my bill does not take anything away from you. It doesn't take anything. No, it doesn't.
It prevents me from having the right to not be fired on the basis of that.
You don't have a, there is no right to not be fired in that instance, and my bill doesn't take away or diminish any of the rights that you currently have. It doesn't. What it says is that, and my bill really deals mostly, not with employers, but it deals with churches and religious institutions, that they're not going to be discriminated again by the federal government if they continue to believe in traditional marriage.
But I would be able to be fired for no reason other than being from,
my bill doesn't do anything about that.
Sure.
No, what you're looking for is for protections at the state level.
Yeah, I'm looking for protection from
my bill doesn't deal with those protections
because
at the state level.
Because you don't believe you should protect
vulnerable
populations.
Special rights.
Thank you for taking my question. The great pillar of America is our elections. We know as a positive fact that Russia influenced our election or made the best effort to do so. We have some pretty heavy smoke coming out of collusion coming from the Trump side. And my question to you is, every Democrat has asked for a special commission to look into the issue, right down to what our democracy is all about. My question to you is where is your outrage? Where exactly, when is it that democracy comes ahead of being a Republican? Let's get to the very bottom of exactly what happened here. About who you are, Mr. Lavender, and I would ask that you go back.
and make the best effort possible to deliver a special commission to look into Trumpgate and get to the bottom of what this situation is.
So you said that there's evidence.
There is smoking evidence.
That they interfere. There's no evidence that they interfere. There's evidence that they try to interfere, and but there's no evidence of collusion. There's two committees, and the FBI are investigating this. Remember, the two committees are bipartisan. They are bipartisan. And he's no longer investigating it. So you have two committees that are bipartisan. You have the FBI director, who was the FBI director from the previous administration, and Trump just said that he's not, which I think is the right thing, he's not getting rid of this FBI director. He couldn't, I don't think, under the law anyway, because their appointments were 10 years. So I believe that the proper committees and the proper agencies are investigating this. If there is evidence of actual criminality, as I said before, I think it should be prosecuted to the fullest extent of the law.
How much evidence do we need? Roger Stone. The whole list. The whole list is there.
So far, there's no evidence of actual criminality. You know. That's what the FBI is doing, and that's what the committees are doing.
My name is Tex Beecham.
Make sure you speak into the microphone so everybody can hear you.
Is it better? Recently, Donald Trump took aggressive military actions in both Syria and Afghanistan, made threatening remarks to North Korea, and sent an armada to the China Sea. These actions have provoked Russia and China and put many of our allies in a high state of tension and anxiety. Given these circumstances, why isn't Congress demanding that Trump seek congressional authority to wage war? Further, why hasn't Congress insisted that the State Department be fully staffed around the world to obey the fears of the allies and North Korean solutions?
So I don't know if you saw my statement last week, but I actually asked for Trump to come to Congress and ask for authorization for using the military. I do want to distinguish the two first events that you talked about. So the first one is what the actions in Syria, and the second ones are the actions in Afghanistan, okay? So I'll start with Afghanistan. In Afghanistan, we are at war. And what Trump did with the military leaders in Afghanistan is he said, you guys have the full authority now to do everything that is necessary to end this war, to go in and use all the military power that is necessary to finish the job that we started. I actually support President Trump in that aspect of what he did. Because I want our men and women that are in the military that have been fighting for the last 12 years, I want them to come home. I want us to finish our mission, and I want them to come home, and I want us to end our incursions in the Middle East. The Syria event is a totally different event. I think it's very dangerous for us to get involved in the middle of a civil war in the Middle East. And I'm more concerned, and I watched the picture, and I think like most of you, those of you who are with Trump on this or against him, we all watch the pictures of what's happening in Syria, and it breaks your heart. You think about what's happening there, and it's a terrible thing. But what happens in the Middle East when we get rid of leaders, secular leaders, even when they're evil men like he is, what ends up happening is that we create a vacuum. And that vacuum then is filled by more evil people that at that point, they're usually followers of ISIS or Al-Qaeda. And what ends up happening is that we replace one monster who is not necessarily a threat to the United States with another monster who is a threat to the United States. So I think we should be very careful in Syria and in other areas.
I don't have a problem with politics in either of those areas.
Yeah.
What bothers me is that I see Trump suddenly exercising military might, an armada on top of that.
Army commanders,
I'm grateful that Trump is showing some spine. And I'm grateful that he's showing the world that there's new leadership.
But I do think if there's going to be any new incursions into any area, that he needs to come to Congress and make the case to the American people.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you.
My name is Karen Seco. I actually live in Congressman Simpson's district. But my question is, who of the Republicans have Mr. Trump's ear that can go to him? Are you one that can go to him and make it clear that he is making us the laughingstock of not the whole world, especially our allies, by conducting diplomacy by Twitter, going off half-cocked.
So a couple of issues. First, I don't think he's making the United States a laughingstock. Are going to become stronger. I do agree with you, though, and I have said this publicly before, I do agree with you that I wish he would use Twitter a little bit less, and I think he should be really careful. But I actually think we're getting better relationships throughout the region. He just had a great meeting with the president of China. He's doing some things that are good. And I think things are going to improve. But I understand that you guys all disagree with me on that.
Just one thing. I know when I was growing up in Germany with my dad who was in the Air Force, even just acquaintances that you passed in the street would shake hands. And for him not to shake hands with Chancellor Merkel was the biggest insult.
I think the best thing that we can all do, frankly, is stop spending so much time watching either MSNBC or Fox News. That is just not a true statement. He shook Angela Merkel's hand. So, actually watch all of them. I want to be informed and watch every single channel.
Thank you for being here.
Yeah.
Before everybody boos me on my comments here.
Make sure you speak up, though.
Okay, we got you. I've got 11-year-old twins. And I am not a Republican, I'm not a Democrat. I'm registered as a Republican because they're the only ones that allow me to mark a box that says I'm a constitutionalist. That makes me wonder what it is right there. I've been teaching my twins, which are 11, the Constitution. As I read through the Constitution, I notice the first 9 out of 10 bills in the Bill of Rights are under attack by our federal government. Some are not even followed. I just want to make sure, first of all, that as I teach them these things, they're not in prison by the time they're 25 for standing up for the constitutional rights. For instance, we have free speech training. We have surveillance out of control. I have to get a permit to assemble more than 20 people. I can't go down to my Capitol building and protest without a permit. Then it seems like when they give you a permit, they give someone else a permit who's totally against you right after that. Taxes are completely out of proportion. I've watched the imprisonment of ranchers, an assassination of one who was just standing up for the Constitution. Our government tells us how to raise our children. We have a health care bill that I'm being fined every year because I can't afford the health care. You're fining me for not affording something. That seems a little ridiculous. I've seen it too many times where you're guilty until proven innocent. I watched in Nevada where they didn't even allow the Constitution in the courtroom. Judge Morrow kicked people out of the courtroom for having the Constitution in their pocket. By a government that can't even balance a budget. I ran my household that way, I'd be living in the street. Am I supposed to tell my children at this point, don't read the Constitution, leave it well enough alone, it's going to get you in prison? Or can I actually tell them, stand up for your constitutional rights and be an American for a change, and let's stand together, because the party system, first of all, is destroying this country. The left, the right, everybody wants to fight each other, and it's not each other who's supposed to be fighting. This country is run by we, the people. So, can I count on you fighting more? I mean, you fight, I understand you want less big government. So do I. They steal too much of my money. You pay 50% in taxes. I don't care what anybody says. By the time your fees, regulations, and everything else comes out of your pocket, 50%.
Can we get to the question?
Can you tell me that I should be teaching my children the Constitution at this point?
Absolutely. You have to teach the Constitution. And even the folks that are here that I disagree with you maybe on some of the politics, they are also trying to fight for the Constitution. That's what I appreciate about what all of you guys are doing. We're going to disagree on a lot of things, but I understand that what you want is a transparent government that takes care of the needs, that follows the Constitution. And I appreciate that, and I think it's good. And I think you should proudly take the Constitution to the school and anywhere else that you need to take it to. So I apologize. We have a long line. We're not going to be able to get to everybody. So we're going to try to do, is it 8:30? 8:30. So we were supposed to end at 8. What I'm going to do is we're going to go to 9 o'clock. And so if you could please make the questions fast, okay?
Thank you for coming tonight. My name is Steve Bennett, and I'm alarmed at the Trump administration's dismantling of the clean energy policies of the Obama administration. I believe that climate change is a really serious issue, and the Trump administration is also threatening to pull out of the Paris Accords. I believe America needs to be a leader in addressing climate change and all the problems that go along with that. How do you feel about that?
I disagree with you. So I'm going to get to it. I know. So I think climate change is real. It happens. The question is whether it's man-made or not man-made. If you look at the history, climate has always changed. There have been warmer times. I am super popular tonight.
Congressman, I have a question about the ACA.
Yes.
And how you will be affected by it personally. From what I understand, members of the Congress and their staff are required to now under the ACA.
Correct.
Correct.
Yes.
All right.
Yeah, we actually are the only people in the United States that have to purchase our insurance plans through the ACA through our employer.
Okay.
It's not a big deal, but that's we have to purchase our insurance plans too. So go ahead.
Okay, but while a typical American may only be able to afford the basic plan, you all can choose the most expensive plans that you would like to have with the government's support. I have to believe that you're pretty irate when you all had to drop out of the federal employee health benefit plan, which is the Cadillac of plans.
That was a better plan, actually.
Yeah, and then I say that. Okay, so you know what? If you and the Republicans had worked in a bipartisan manner to better the ACA instead of fighting it tooth and nail, perhaps I wouldn't be here asking this question of you. There will be heck to pay, and I'm using that term.
Yes.
But how about if there is a repeal, how about if you stand up for all of us and not think of yourselves and your spouse going back on that federal plan.
Government employees are government employees. If you want to change the entire system for government employees, I don't disagree with you. But members of Congress and their staff are government employees. And they receive the same benefits that every other government employee receives. In fact, I think all of you may have received an email that says that we receive all these exorbitant benefits, that we receive benefits that go on for life and things like that. That email is not true. We don't receive, after 2 years, you know, lifetime health insurance or anything like that. We're treated like every other government employee and our staff.
But you're on the ACA.
What?
You yourself.
Well, right now I'm on the ACA.
You're on the ACA, and your staff. And I'll tell you what, I've heard from staff that they were very unhappy and they had to go off and pay more. My goodness, they'd have to pay as much as we do. How sad.
Thank you, Representative. My name is Mark Mayfield, and I just have a question that I became aware of, and that is net neutrality.
Yes.
You probably know the term. Okay. How do you feel about cable companies trying to force not only consumers, but also people that advertise through them? And then what's going to happen is there's going to be less competition because you're going to get a rate that,
explain a little bit more so that the people.
Okay.
Yeah.
So right now we pay for cable, for internet and for TV and stuff like that. And so we pay the cable companies. The cable companies want to set a minimum payment from other businesses. And what's going to happen is only the big ones that can pay it will stay on the net. And all the rest of them either go real slow or because they can't pay, they're not, so the net is not free.
Right.
Yeah.
So if you look at what's happened over the last maybe 20 years or a little bit more, a lot of the growth in the United States has come through the internet, a lot of the financial growth in the United States. One of the reasons that we have had so much financial growth in that area, and it has really driven most of the growth in the United States, is because there's very little regulation on the internet. The internet is free, and people can use the internet any way that they want. Some of it is good, some of it is not so good, but it's free, and it's allowed some these businesses to thrive. If we start getting involved and trying to regulate the internet, what's going to happen is exactly what you just said, that the big companies are going to be able to afford all the regulations, and the little guys that are trying to grow and to become the next big companies are not going to be able to grow. So I am for freedom on the internet, and I want to make sure that we keep it.
Thank you.
Hi, Congressman Lindbergh. My name is Andrea Wassner, and I've got a couple of questions that probably I don't think are partisan issues.
Okay.
But others might. It has to do with the funding of the Social Security Administration, which does touch every single person in this room. And I've been lobbying back in D.C. for over 20 years on this issue. And one of the questions we've always asked, and I asked when you were on government reform, is why does an agency such as Social Security, that pretty much funds itself through the FICA tax that we all have taken out of our wages or our net self-employment, why do we have to compete under the labor HHS bills against people like agencies like Head Start, unemployment, state disability, those type of things? Why do we compete when we are basically self-funding and we do a very good job? But why do the other agencies have to compete with us when our money's not coming out of the general tax fund for most of the administration of the agency? The benefits are off budget. Why can't we take the administrative expenses off budget and leave congressional oversight, but take us out of the labor HHS appropriation process?
It's a great question I frankly haven't thought about, so I'm going to have to think about that a little bit. But I just want to clarify something. Social Security is self-funding, but we are running out of money in Social Security, so we do have to figure out. So I'm separating all the other.
I was going to say, that's not part of the question.
I know, but But I don't know the answer to your question, and I will try to think about that. But that's a great question I hadn't even thought about. So that's a great question.
You've had letters to your staff and lobbying for the last, since you've been in office, and
I get thousands.
Okay, one more. Social Security's primary source of funding.
I'm sorry, we don't have time for another question.
Okay, thank you.
So, sorry.
Scientists are trying to do is to create law, so I think they should leave the law to the law. Yeah.
Okay, so
I should make the policy, they should do the science. And I agree with you 100%.
You can't refute the science. You have to start there. So let's do that. So there's a lot to be concerned about right now. Some of it can be changed with changing representation, some of it couldn't. One of the bigger underlying concerns that I have right now is the political divide. We've become a country of blue versus red, dividing Americans into teams of winners and losers. You and I will not always agree on policy, but the bottom line, I am your constituent, and your set is my representative too. When I read your newsletters and I watch your interviews, I'm often disheartened to see that me and my values are made up to be some kind of a threat. I commit to you right now that I will always root for your success as my representative, and I will treat you with the same respect and dignity that I give to all of my friends and neighbors. I ask you to let your policies stand on their own 2 feet, abandon the political rhetoric, and treat me and all of your constituents with the same respect, and not make everything an issue of red versus blue.
And this is why I disagree with you. The way I've treated you tonight is just the way I treat all people. And I gotta tell you why, okay? You have to realize that what I told you about growing up in a single parent home, my mom was a Democrat. The person I loved the most in the world until I married my wife was a Democrat. She and I disagreed on politics all the time, but we had respect for each other. I have always tried to treat people of different opinions very respectfully, just like I have tried to do the same tonight.
And in a face-to-face exchange, you have. But I get your newsletters. I'm your constituent. I read it. And almost on a regular basis, I see something about the Democrats.
They're about policy.
It's not always on policy. And I can point to a couple examples, but there's a lot of people that want to wait. Yeah. They're waiting. I just encourage you to put your country first and recognize that we're all working towards the same goal.
So the way that health insurance worked, and I explained this a little bit earlier, so I'm going to try to do it really quickly. The way health insurance worked before is that those essential benefits were not requirements of every insurance plan. So what happened is that there were different variations of plans that people could afford. Some young people, for example, didn't want all of those benefits, and they would pay smaller premiums for those plans. So what I want to do is not make it a requirement, and I hope you're following what I'm saying. I don't want that to be a requirement, so most people will have reduced health insurance rates, But for the people who cannot afford it, we are putting subsidies in there so they can actually receive the health insurance plans that have all those essential benefits. We're not saying that the insurance companies should not provide those essential benefits. We're saying that not every plan needs to provide those essential benefits so that people who want to afford the lower premiums can pay the lower premiums, and the people that need those essential benefits can afford it because there's going to be subsidies that are going to help them pay for plans that have those essential benefits. So that's what we're trying to do. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Gina Peterson, and this is the 11th election for the president that I voted in. I've won some, and I've lost some.
Me too.
But I've never been viscerally afraid of what the president could do to our country, our constitution, and our democracy in America. And I find it disconcerting that our president called up the president of Turkey to congratulate him on winning his questionable election on turning the country into a dictatorship. And Congress's job is to hold him accountable, and it does start with the taxes. We need his taxes for the Russia investigation, and yes, we still need an independent investigation. We need it for his conflict of interest, and we need it for tax reform. We can have no tax reform without his taxes. Because we don't know what laws he's going to enact that will benefit himself and his base. We don't know what policies or laws he's going to enact that will benefit himself and his family. And because I believe he only cares about two things, worshiping money and being worshipped, I don't trust him to do this for all the people. So I ask the Congress to do their job to protect our Constitution and prevent the president from turning our democracy into a kleptocracy towards authoritarian government.
So I'm going to be brief because we've talked about this all night, so I'm not going to keep repeating myself. But the important thing is, as you think about what the president is doing, there were, and I'm not trying to, if somebody said, well, don't bring Obama up. There were people who felt the same way you feel right now about Obama. In fact, you might want to disagree with that, but people felt that way about Obama. In fact, I'm not going to ask you a question. When Obama decided to have a better relationship with Iran, were you equally concerned?
Yes. He didn't congratulate someone on making his
country. He allowed Iran to actually have more access to nuclear things. The point I'm trying to make, I'm not trying to judge one versus the other. There are things that you find objectionable about this president, just like there were things that other people found equally objectionable about the other president. I'm not talking about the Constitution a number of times tonight. I didn't see anybody at my town hall meetings objecting when the President of the United States in the previous administration got overturned by the Supreme Court more often than any president in history. So things happen where presidents make decisions that might be constitutional or not constitutional. And the most important thing is that we can, just because you disagree with the president doesn't mean that we need to be as concerned. I actually think there's some things that are good that he's doing, and we need to work together as the American people. Thank you. I think I've answered the question about taxes like 10 times, so I'm not taxing.
We've got to answer questions for everybody.
Yeah, we're not going to have time, I'm sorry.
Okay. I've been a Republican all my life until the crash, and then I started fact-checking.
You started what?
Fact-checking.
Yes.
That's what some of the people in Congress should do. what I wanted to talk about, everybody's gone over, but I will say that the ACA or Obamacare, which I'm proud to say is under his name, you and your the rest of Congress had 6 years. 6 years to do something, we didn't do a damn thing. Nothing. And now, afterwards, you finally are clear and ready to do something, and you're clueless. You have no way to go, you can't get together, and the multi-billion dollar industry of the medical is owned by the lobbyists, and I think the Republicans are afraid to do anything, say anything, because the lobbyists own you. Further, I would like to say that prior...
Can I answer your question so I can get real quick? Right. If you think that lobbyists own me, you haven't followed the last 10 years of my life. But you know who the biggest industry that's opposed to the changes that I wanted to the ACA is? The insurance lobby. Because what those things that I'm trying to get rid of in the ACA actually make the insurance companies more profits. When you can charge people for things that they don't need, you make more money. It's just basic economics.
Why didn't you bring up the one pay system then? That's never been brought up.
The what?
So, one pay system.
So I believe that the changes are trying to, the biggest lobby against the changes that I want to make to the insurance company, to the insurance industry, are the insurance companies. If you look at the last 8 years under Obamacare, the number one industry that supported Obamacare was the insurance industry. And now they oppose the changes that I want, because in the last 8 years, insurance companies have doubled in profits. Because when you can charge people for something that they're not using, you're going to make more money. So actually, I'm with you. I want to be able to make sure that the people can afford health insurance and that the insurance companies don't make as big of a profit.
6 years. Okay, now that's not enough.
It's got to be, we got to ask other people. Yeah.
See what happens?
One question per person, please.
Hey, thank you again for coming. I'm a Minnesota girl, and I moved here in 78, and I'm a special ed teacher. And I just came because I find it alarming that in 1980, the rate of children diagnosed on the autism spectrum disorder was 1 in 2,000. Do you know what it is now? 1 in 35 kids are diagnosed with autism now. And it costs more than $26,500 per adult annually to raise these kids and school them. And if we're going from 1 in 2,000 to 1 in 45, and you cut the budget, how are we supposed to educate all of these kids on the autism spectrum disorder? We need help. So I am asking you what you can do for getting more money to special ed, because it is a federal law, and how can we find out what is causing autism in our country? I mean, this is a really important bipartisan issue. And my other question is...
That's it. I apologize. Okay. Yeah. And I, frankly, I don't know much about autism. In fact, I was told by several people not to try to be a scientist, so I'm not going to try to be a scientist. It's something that... I just don't know enough about autism, and I think I would give you a bad answer. I don't know what we can do.
You can't fund special ed better, and you can't fund a study so we can finally find out what
we are funding studies.
It's been years and years and years, and still nothing.
I know, but I think the funding, the studies are being funded.
So just a quick interjection. We're almost an hour over. We do have a town hall on Monday night, so we'll have another crack at this. But we just time for two more questions, and then we'll need to be done.
We are your constituents.
Yes, we've been here 3 hours.
Yeah.
talking about the town hall. I'm listening to us.
I'm going to be doing other town halls.
You can't get a question.
My name is Harry Stepanico. I'm a member. I live in Star, and I am under Social Security. This is a follow-up question, which you didn't get a chance to answer.
That's fine.
Right. Here it comes. The Social Security Administration is forecast to be insolvent in the 1930s. And at that point, there will be reduced benefits. There will be reduced benefits.
Correct.
Okay. Now, under Bush 43, he proposed privatizing Social Security, which didn't, the majority of the population did not support.
Correct.
You are a person that supports limited government. Question, what is your position on Social Security?
Great question. So, we have to look at the Social Security and how it started and how it is today. As you know, when Social Security started, we had one worker receiving benefits for every three workers who were working. Mm-hmm. Today, we have 17 workers working for every, the other way around.
Yeah.
The other way around, 17 working,
two.
Yes, yeah. For everyone. Now it's one worker working for two workers working for every person receiving benefits. So we have to figure out how to reform Social Security, because what's going to happen eventually is that it's going to go insolvent. And there are certain things that we can do. One approach is the one that Bush gave, which is privatizing Social Security, making sure that the people that are receiving benefits right now do not get affected, but people like myself maybe use a different program, which is a privatized Social Security. Another approach that I actually favor is figuring out how we can slowly increase the age of retirement and allow people to, it won't affect you, but it will affect me. Right now people not only, remember also when Social Security started, the reason they picked the age of 65 is because the average lifespan was 67. So now we have people that are living into their 80s and their 90s and still working under the same program. So we have to figure out how to extend the life of Social Security and make sure that every American can receive those benefits.
There is a third option that has been proposed by other people, and that is increasing the cap.
Yes, sir.
That's what the cap in America is trying to Social Security. Obviously, since you don't support more taxes,
I know, yes.
You're not going to go that far.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Hi, Congressman. I'm Brandi Sindel, the founder of Stanton Healthcare, which you may know is a nonprofit women's center that doesn't charge for any of our services. We reach out to women facing unexpected pregnancies. We've also launched our STD program. We do a variety of different things, and we don't charge for any of our services. We reach out to the uninsured. We take our mobile medical clinic out to rural areas that are underserved. We reach out to the refugee communities. We do quite a few things, and we're growing tremendously here in Idaho and also around the nation. Part of our heart and our mission is also to create awareness that Planned Parenthood is not only the largest abortion provider in the world, but that they also misuse tax dollars.
We have been respectful to people on the other side.
On a couple different things. First of all, one of the most recent things that we've launched, and we just did it last month, and it was amazing, is we partnered with our leading hospital here in Idaho, and they brought their mobile mammogram clinic to Stanton Healthcare. And so we were able to provide mammograms at no cost to women, and we are going to continue this partnership. There is not one Planned Parenthood in the nation or in Idaho that has ever done what we have done. And we have done it without any government funding.
Hey, you know, people who disagree with her had an opportunity to ask
that
question, but do get to the question.
I will get to the question. this was an innovative thing that we've done. My question is to you. You are a principled man. People may agree or disagree, but you have a personal conviction that has created and caused you to be very pro-woman and pro-life. I want to know what it is. And as a woman, thank you for wanting to defund Planned Parenthood. And the women of Idaho stand with you, and millions of women of Idaho stand with you.
I'm not going to get into the details of the mental issue, but I am pro-life, as you know, and I work very hard to make sure that my pro-life values are respected, and I thank you for what you're doing. Let's do two more questions.
Some of us have issues that haven't even been broached yet.
There is a law that says the government cannot negotiate.
Yes. There's a law. Can you speak into the microphone?
Okay. You're interested in bringing down health care, right? Okay. There is a law that says the government cannot negotiate for medicines. The government pays more for medicines than the armed services or anybody else. Because of this law, generic medicines and old medicines are going way high. I had one that was $600. I have insurance, but of course I'm Medicare, but you get your donor code sooner. I have another one that is for arthritis. It is an antibiotic. It's doxycycline. It's an old medicine. It's a generic. And they want $331 without insurance. And I know you've heard this on people that have diabetes. Okay, this must be a congressional law. Get rid of it.
So I agree with you. I think we need to be able to negotiate more on.
Well, why aren't they? Where is this law? Congress passed that law.
Okay. I don't serve on the committee that deals with that issue, but I do agree with you that we need to do something about this. I've talked to my pharmacist about this point of view, and we have seen an increase lately in all these generic drugs, and I have asked my colleagues who work on the committee to please look at that, and I've talked to my pharmacist quite a bit. Well, I agree with you. We need to do something about it.
Why can't we change the law? Is this a congressional law?
I'm not sure exactly what is causing it, but I think we need to look into it, and I agree with you 100%.
My medication is $70,000 a year. We need to negotiate.
Thank you for being here, Congressman. I think I'm going to be compassionate to you. This is the last question of the night. And you look really exhausted. My question to you is,
I understand.
Are you aware of H.R. 299?
I am not.
H.R. 299 is the Blue Water Navy Vietnam Veterans Act of 2017. It's in subcommittee at the moment. They had hearings on April 5th, so I don't know what's happened after the hearing. Basically, I'm trying to make it very, very short. In 1991, sailors that were off the coast of Vietnam were granted benefits and compensation for being exposed to Agent Orange while they were offshore. In 2002, the VA said, oops, we're not gonna give you any more benefits, and they stopped paying compensation and benefit to those sailors. There's been repeated attempts by different Congress people to resurrect this problem and to have the VA reinstate benefit to Blue Water sailors. And currently, the only one that's active and that's alive is H.R. 299. Can you please make it a point for you to get familiar with this
H.R. 299.
299. It's
okay.
In subcommittee at the
moment. We will look at it.
Thank
Absolutely.
You.
Thank you. Okay, let's just do two more. I do think these have to be the last two. So.
Thank you very much.
Why do you use campaign contributions to pay your wife's salary? That seems a little shady. I've been waiting 3 hours to ask that question. I've lived for my whole life.
I will answer that question.
It's not your turn. I will answer the question, but it's not your turn, so let's be respectful. Let her ask her question.
Thank you. I have been a city planner for much of my career, so I know what goes into creating a successful community. One of those things is the arts. The arts contribute to the local economy, and by creating a vital, active community, I have seen the eyes of children get excited when they see the Idaho Shakespeare Festival come to their school, funded by the National Endowment for the Arts. And so I ask you and I beg you to talk to your colleagues. I know that's not your committee, but in working on the budget, talk to your colleagues in this state and as well as the rest of the Congress, to please do not decimate the funding for the National Endowment for the Arts and the Humanities.
Let me answer the question that was asked, and then I'll talk to you. Yes, my wife works for the campaign.
Yep.
She does all of the finances for the campaign. She has the job that she does, and she gets paid exactly what any other employee doing the same job that she's doing for the campaign would do.
You don't think that's so shady?
I don't. So, because she's doing work for it, and I did it for a reason. Just so you know. I had a business where my finances, I had several employees steal thousands of dollars from my business. I have never had anybody, during the campaign, we have never had any problem with the finances of the business. So we're doing it to make sure that the finances of the campaign are actually taken care of and accounted for, and I think that's a good thing.
Thank you. Two things, just a quick request and then a quick question.
Yeah.
The first is, and I've already talked to your aide, can you see the rest of the people currently in line? They have been waiting 2 or 3 hours. And I identified a solution that will work for you better in the future with your aide. The second thing is a quick question, and it's actually about the first question you received. I'm sure you'll remember that one.
Yes.
It's about your position on states' rights versus federal.
Okay.
I don't necessarily disagree with you wholeheartedly on that. But I do have a concern because I'm an individual liberty supporter.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, government is government regardless of which branch it is or which level it is. So when you look at education, for instance, and you believe that states should be more in the model of control, I don't disagree, but if you completely remove federal oversight, how do you guarantee that my grandchildren are going to have the same basic quality education if they move to another state?
That's actually a great question. And the problem is that I think you should make sure that the school board at the local level is doing the work that is necessary. You can elect the school board, you can elect the legislature, you can do those things and make sure that we're having the level of education. And I think it would be more effective. We would also, all that money that's being sent to Washington, D.C., that money would be stayed here at the local level so we could have more money for our education and use it better and more effectively.
Respectfully, that wasn't answering my question. Let me clarify. It's probably my fault. I understand the fiscal part. I'm a fiscal conservative. I do understand that. My concern is about individual liberty. And I understand you can vote in your board. You can vote in your state legislatures. But state legislatures are more likely to have a different understanding of individual liberties from state to state. And to tell a U.S. citizen that they have to move to another state if they don't like those laws, I think is unjust when it comes to basic things such as education.
I understand your position. I just think my job is to make sure that the education in Idaho is the best education, and I want to work with you in partnership to make sure that we improve the education. And again, I'll give you the same answer I gave before. We have the Department of Education, and a lot of you have complained about the education in Idaho. Even with the Department of Education, we're not getting the results that we want. I think we can do better at the state level, and I think we have a responsibility to do that.
One last thing.
We can't.
Thank you. I'd like to ask a question in addition. We haven't talked about it at all.
I can't hear you.
All right. I'd like to ask a question about an issue that hasn't been discussed.
The what?
About an issue that hasn't been discussed.
Okay.
72% of Americans want the federal government to continue to be in charge of public lands. Idaho has sold 41% of its public lands, and they often do not allow the public to even use their lands. Idaho cannot afford to keep school structures up to code. They certainly could never afford the millions required to manage and fight fires on public lands. Will you commit to protecting these lands that Idahoans love and need to use and want to pass on to future generations rather than get a one-term, very short-sighted monetary payout for it? You have voted, sir, to allow the sale of public lands, even at no profit. You have voted to allow the discharge of coal dust into streams. It's like we've gone back to the 1930s. If you don't appreciate the environment and public lands, we do. Please keep your hands off of them. Will you commit to protecting them?
I am committed to protecting them. And if you look at the state
then why are you trying to sell them?
I'm not trying to sell them. I've never advocated or voted for any legislation that sells public land. What I want is active management of our state, of our federal lands, at this state level. We have state lands
the
that are better.
Solvers.
So I think we manage the forest and the lands better than the federal government. We do. Just look around the state forest and look at the federal forest. They're healthier and more vibrant.
Good evening, Congressman. Thank you for staying. My name is Rachel Saluga, and I am a patriot, and I am also a proud Planned Parenthood utilizer, or at least I was in the past. Luckily, I have good insurance now, so that's not an issue. But that's not what I'm here to talk about. What I'm here to talk about is you said earlier today that you have no problem separating yourself from the party when necessary, like in regards to the Affordable Care Act situation or whatever they tried to do to repeal it. Where the hell were you when Trump was getting away with the inflammatory things he was saying? How he openly mocked a reporter. The day after the election, I had to explain to my stepson how we elected a monster. Where were you? Where were you? And what do you have to say to my 11-year-old and 6-year-old stepsons about how you can do such horrible things and still become the highest elected office in the world, or in the country? Why did you not stand up? Why? I had to send my own father a text message that morning because he's a lifelong Republican. I assumed he voted Trump. I had to say to him, I hope no one grabs me you know where, because our president can get away with it. He couldn't even stomach Trump. He wrote in John Kasich because he loves me enough, he loves my mom enough, he loves my aunt, he loves women enough to understand that that's not acceptable behavior. Where were you? Why did you not speak out? You put party over principle. Where were you?
I didn't support Trump in the primaries. I supported somebody else.
I don't care.
I know you don't care, but the reality is that I supported somebody else, and I had a choice between Trump and Hillary Clinton.
There were two other circumstances.
In my opinion, a vote for anybody else would have been a vote for Hillary Clinton, and I don't think she was good for the future of the United States. She was good for the future.
I'm a burned believer, okay? I get that. I get the hatred of Hillary. But where do you draw the line? And what are you going to say to my stepchildren about how you treat women, how you treat minorities, and how you treat those with disabilities? What is your response?
I have treated them all very, very, very fairly my whole life. And that's my example.
I appreciate you staying to take those last few questions. My name is Manny Lewis. I'm a constituent in district. At the end of 2016, Congress passed the broadest bipartisan-supported 21st Century Cures Act, which increased support to NIH, the National Institute of Health. You were one of 26 dissenting votes in the House against this act. Now that we are in the new year and we're looking at the budget for the year upcoming, The White House has suggested a $1 billion cut to the National Institute of Health for the remainder of this year and a $5.4 billion cut to the National Institute of Health next year. What will you do to ensure our cancer researchers and other medical researchers in our state and across the country have the financial resources that they need to find new treatment options for patients?
Good question. So the bill that you're talking about, I actually supported until they made a change at the last minute on the bill. The change at the last minute created a new entitlement program, a new mandatory spending program that was going to continue to increase exponentially. I wanted it to be part of the discretionary budget, not part of the mandatory spending budget. So when they made that change, I voted against it, even though I had supported the bill the entire time that it had been going through the process. I think, and several people have asked the questions about this budget. Remember, the Trump budget is not the budget that passes through Congress. The Trump budget is sort of his aspirational budget, and we get to pass in Congress our budget, the things that we're gonna do. We're gonna have money for funding. We all believe that it's important to have money for cancer research, for all those things. And I think we're gonna continue to fund those
will priorities. Will you commit to supporting staying at a level, if not increasing the budget to NIH?
I'm gonna look at the budget as it comes before us, but we will make those decisions when the budget comes. But the budget that most people have been talking about here is not the budget that is eventually gonna pass out of Congress. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Nicole Velasquez, and I'm a volunteer with the Patriot Cancer Action Network. And so that's the first comment I've heard about the budget, and so that's exactly what I'm here for. And if you will commit to not allowing that $5.8 billion cut to NIH in the 2017 budget, pancreatic cancer is now the third leading cause of cancer. Pancreatic cancer is the third leading cause of cancer death, surpassed breast cancer, likely to be the second in 2020. And I know we've reached out to you many times for meetings to let you know how your constituents are affected by pancreatic cancer, because the stories are unbelievable. And we send a group to Advocacy Day every day in D.C. We've never had a chance to meet with you. We've always met with your staff. So just my question to you is maybe that you could commit to meeting with us at Advocacy Day and really hearing the stories of how cancer affects.
Has that been in Washington?
It's in Washington, D.C. in June.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, the Capitol Hill is purple, and we'd love to see it.
All right, thank you.
Hi, my name is Eva DeRosa, and I'd just like to say thank you for how late you stayed. I know you must be exhausted standing up there, but thank you.
If I fall off the stage, will you catch me, you know?
I promise I'll try. As a high school senior, my friends and I are currently in the process of preparing for college. This includes, perhaps most importantly, how to pay for college. I have friends who are not going to college simply because they cannot afford to pay for it. I have friends who have so much potential who are stopping their education too early. I also have friends who will simply be buried in student debt once they graduate from college. What will you do to make college more affordable for Idahoans, including myself?
First of all, we do need to look, and I think the question was asked earlier about what's happening in Idaho, that not enough students are going on to college, and I think that's a travesty. I think we need to make sure that we encourage more students to go to college. I also think we have a lot of educational opportunities. One of the problems we have with education, and I know I'm going to get booed, but please listen at least to the answer, and then you can boo after that. One of the problems we have with education, the more government involvement we have in education, the more expensive it has become. So what happens is that we start increasing Pell Grants, or we start doing those things, and we're doing that because we think that's helping the students. What ends up happening is that the colleges and universities start increasing the cost of education. So anytime you include more and more government in education, you're making it less affordable for students, and you have student debts. I graduated from college 25 years ago. You're graduating now. The student debt that I had from 25 years ago was a lot less because college was a lot more affordable. We need to start thinking about, it's not bringing more government into the student loan programs and other programs. It's actually figuring out how we can reduce the cost of education. And we have to figure out how to do that because it's becoming more and more expensive. And the problem that we have is that students are finding themselves that they can't go. I also encourage people to go to their state schools, to find programs. I ended up going to a school, a religious school, because that was the one that I could afford because the rates were much cheaper than any other school I could go to. So I ended up having a lot less student loans and a lot less expenses, and I tried to work for scholarships and all those things. So we have to figure out that, and then we have to be morally responsible for our own lives, and we have to decide, what am I going to graduate in? What are the studies that I'm going to do, and is that going to be able to provide for me and my family? Those are all decisions that I try to teach my kids. I have three kids in college right now, and I'm encouraging them to make all those decisions, and they decide what schools they go to, but they know that they're also going to be the ones paying for their education as we help them with other things. So you have to make those decisions, and that's why I think the state colleges are a great opportunity for most students.
Sir, I'd just like to respectfully disagree. I've received federal grants, and they're the reason I'm going to be able to attend college in the fall, but I do appreciate your honesty, and thank you.
I received Fed grants as well, but we have to be careful because the more government you get involved in education, you can just look at the data. The more we have increased the grants and the more we have increased the amount of loans, it's actually made the cost of education much higher for the average American. It's just a fact.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, Congressman.
Thank you.
What? I did again. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
I just want to take a minute to thank you for your service to the country and to your strong pro-life effort. It's a big blessing to Idaho. Thank you.
Thank you.
I think if one of you gets over here, you might actually get, I guess it'll be about the same, so.
Thank you, Christine.
Yeah.
My husband and I will be paying over $19,000 this year for child care for our children. He only received
what was that? Can you say?
$19,000 we'll pay this year for child care for both of our children. We only received a $300 tax credit when we did our taxes. What will you do to change the tax code so it's more fair for working class?
I think what we need to do is we need to reduce taxes for people. Not, you and I are going to disagree here again, but I don't think we need to find more ways to spend the taxpayer money. I think we need to figure out how we can make taxes lower. I also think we need to figure out how to create better jobs so people can afford child care and other things. We have to figure out how to help businesses thrive in Idaho and other things. But I just, and I've given this answer a couple of times, I just don't think it's the responsibility of government to be paying for child care for families and other things. I know you disagree with me, but that's just the only answer that I can give you. Thank you very much.
I want to add my appreciation for you coming before your constituents, and I know it's not an easy job to stand out there. I actually don't have a question, I have a suggestion.
Please.
Quick one, but given the fact that healthcare is a very complex issue, everybody knew it except Trump, it is an issue that is emotionally charged because it deals with life, death, and quality of life. It is politically charged, and it contributes a significant part of our economy. So my suggestion is that the Senate and the House commission an independent group of experts to actually study the issue. It seems to me that every time I hear a politician, whether it's right or left, whether it's Fox News or whether it's MSNBC, I get opinions. And I don't want opinions, and I really don't give a hoot what's right theology is. I would like facts. And you need a commission that is made up of doctors, nurses, ex-insurance executives, ex-pharmaceutical industry people that don't have a financial interest anymore, to actually study the issue. And it doesn't have to go on forever. It could be done in 6 months because we are the only industrialized country that does not provide for public health insurance. So there's like 13, 15 different countries that you can go study and find out what's working and what isn't working. And I actually looked up, because it's so hard to find facts, but I went to the internet and actually read Canadian news. And you know, the facts appear that we actually in the United States average almost $10,000 per capita, and we get far less as compared to, say, Canada, that's not up to $5,000 per capita.
So it's true. So we have studied many of those countries, and if you look at Canada, for example, they have a less diverse country and a smaller population, and they actually have a lot of people who come to the United States to receive their health care because they're not happy with their health care.
That is not true. What they come to America for is for those items which are not. They don't have immediate needs.
So I was going to say the next issue that Canada has is that they ration health care. So is that a choice they do? They ration it. So yes, you can.
The medical condition. We ration it on the basis of income.
They have longer waits. So the system is different than ours, but you do have a lot of problems with the Canadian system. Just like you have problems in all these different countries. But the reality is that I don't believe that we should socialize medicine, and I know that you do, but I just don't believe that that should
I be don't good. Know yeah. whether we yeah. should have socialized medicine. One of the big questions is, what does it cost? And the only thing that I ever hear from anybody in Washington is an opinion.
The reality is that to make it affordable, you're going to have to ration health care for all Americans. That's the only way to make it.
I think that makes better sense than just give it to the rich people.
I don't think only the rich people receive health care in the United States. I think most Americans receive health care through some form of another.
That's why you need experts rather than politicians to study it.
I would say I am one of those Americans who does not receive health care. And that's okay, because every dollar that goes from a state pocket to a federal pocket and then comes back only comes back at 50 cents. So if I've told legislators, just keep the money here and don't send it to Washington. They go, we can't do that. Sure we can, it's our money. It's coming out of the same pocket, whether it's going to the state or whether it's going to the feds. So, I learned that you can't reduce healthcare costs until you bring in the insurance companies. I agree with you on that.
Yeah.
There are doctors who have provided payment plans for their patients that don't have healthcare, and they've been penalized for selling insurance. That's horse dropping. So my thing is to reduce the debt, to reduce the deficit, short of a magnetic pulse that eliminates all computers and all of those debts that are only entry on a computer screen in the first place.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, we'd all be out of debt if the computers all went down. My question is, Senator Chaffetz, from Utah.
Congressman Chaffetz.
Oh, yeah, okay. Sorry.
That's right.
Has proposed a bill to audit the Fed. I support that. Do you?
Absolutely. I voted for it. It passed the House, and it's in the Senate right now. And they're going to try to pass it in the Senate.
The ACA is a nightmare. And health care is something that we can't get under ACA. You can't rebuild the house unless you demolish something. So get rid of that.
All right.
tonight that you would support policies that were good for the economy, and that you would support employees asking their employers to give them paid family leave. I managed fast food restaurants for 20 years. During that time, we could not afford to raise employees' wages, or we would have had to lay people off. Also, during that time, if someone had come to us asking for paid family leave, our owners would have immediately denied it. I also went through two federal minimum wage increases. When everybody's minimum wage went up, our sales went through the roof. We hired more people. We made more money. And so if you really are about improving the economy and about employees having the power to ask their employers for better treatment, does that mean you will support a livable wage for everyone and strengthening unions so that employees have the power to demand fair treatment from their employers?
I think employees have a power to make that.
They do not.
And they can ask their employer. What you're seeing in the fast food industry is a good example. My mother worked in the fast food industry. I worked in the fast food industry when I was in college. What you're seeing is that it's going to automation. The moment that you start increasing the minimum wage in fast food, what starts happening is that the employers start looking for ways to save money. And it's actually increasing unemployment in certain segments.
That is actually not true. And the plans that we have seen for automation were there without any discussion of wages.
And I don't disagree with that, but you're seeing an increase in those needs, and you're seeing an increase in the automation.
So what I
encourage people to do, what my mother did, what I did, she decided to get an education. She and I graduated from college the same year.
I'm sorry, sir, but how do you go to college when you're working 70 hours a week to make $40,000 to support poor children?
My mother worked 70 hours a week.
When you are the sole care provider for poor children working 70 hours a week, I enrolled in college the day my youngest child graduated high school. My children grew up in poverty because there was no option until then.
So in my case, that's the example that I had in my home. She was working 50, 60, 70 hours a week. She was working long hours, and she was also trying to improve her life. She also tried to get jobs that paid more. But
was she the sole care provider for four children?
She was the sole care provider for me, but not for four children. So I think there are opportunities out there, but no,
we are prevented from raising the wages of our employees when nobody else does it. Because if we raise the wages, our profits go down. But if everyone's wages go up, our profits do not go down. The sales go up. So if you leave it to the individual employers, it's not possible to do it.
Okay, I just disagree with you. Thank you.
You can look at Seattle for proof, sir.
Okay.
Congressman Lavender, thank you so much for stepping into the lion's den tonight. And it would be really wonderful. You know, you're the only person I voted for that actually is holding a town hall. And it would be nice if you shared it with everybody else who did not hold a town hall. I think you will find them in the witness protection program.
Right?
I do want to be fair for a second. You know, you look at Mike Rapel held 200 town halls over the last 2 years. I mean, there are people who held town halls, and I don't tell other members of Congress how they should, whether they should or shouldn't hold town halls, but I think you've had members of this delegation actually hold town halls in the past and try to reach out to the people. No, that's true, but I think it has happened, and we have a good record. In reality, Mike Rapel was in the top 10 in the whole Congress over the last 2 years. I was in the top 50 in the whole Congress over the last 2 years, and I've been consistently in the. So I think it's a good thing for members of Congress to report.
And for full disclosure, I am registered with Congress, and I am a veteran. I wasn't bussed in or anything. So I am here.
I'm going to need to be bussed out. I'm tired of it. So.
And, you know, I had a whole list of questions. Unfortunately, they've all been answered tonight, except for I do have one thing I'd like to say. I don't know if you've had anybody in your immediate family that's ever had a chronic illness or life-threatening illness, but I have, and I was diagnosed with one. or I don't know if you've ever had anyone that has been turned down for insurance, but I was. I didn't have insurance for 14 years and couldn't afford insurance that I'm married today, but had insurance and I'm insured on his policy. So I understand what it's like not to be insured. And as far as the Affordable Care Act, you know, I don't understand. I have my own business and have had for a number of years. And I don't know why you have to throw out the baby with the bathwater. I understand that there's problems with the Affordable Care Act, but I don't understand why you don't go in and fix the problems. Everything's not a problem. Keep the good things and throw out the bad things, but don't start from scratch. Is it because people are calling it Obamacare?
No, it's because the basic structure of the Affordable Care Act is flawed. It's failing. We're having less and less insurance companies, and some states are actually losing the number of insurance companies that are providing service in those states. We have some states where in 30 or 40% of the state, you have absolutely no coverage for any of the people because the entire structure of the Affordable Care Act is falling under its weight. So we do need to change to make sure that we have a healthcare system that works for all Americans and that continues. So anyway, but I need to get to the next one.
Both the Democrats and the Republicans had a number of years to come up with a health care plan, and they didn't do it until this one came out. Now they want to tear it apart.
You're the second or third person who asked that, and I think people need to remember that Democrats tried to do something on health care for 50 years. When Obama was elected, it took them an entire year to pass Obamacare. So we just started this Congress. I think it's going to take some time to fix something that we disagree with, especially when, so to say that we had 6 years, the Democrats had 50 years and they came up with Obamacare. We're all trying to do what's best for the American people. But it is a difficult thing. We're talking about 1/6 of the economy, and we're going to have to figure out how to do it. It's going to take us some time.
Just remember, there's lives at the bottom of that deal.
Absolutely. I agree with you 100%.
If you run for governor, are you going to resign from Congress?
No.
Not enough time for both.
There's time for both.
What's your take on the refugees coming into Boise?
I can't hear you.
What's your take on the refugees coming into Boise?
So I think we need to have, I have always supported a refugee program. The problem that we have right now is that we are not properly vetting the new refugees that are coming into the United States.
Thank you.
I have a couple statements and then a question. First of all, I appreciate you sticking around to hear all these comments, no matter how negative they are or questionable.
It's my job, right?
I would ask for the health care, if you can pass it as a Congress, that you don't do it in the middle of the night, and you don't pass it so we can see what's in it.
I agree. That's one of my biggest problems with the Republican plan. That we complain about Obama and the Democrats that they did something that was quick, they did it, they negotiated it in the dark and all those things, and then we came up with a bill that we were only going to have 2 weeks to actually read it and get familiar with it. I completely opposed it because that was just not the right process.
You did, of course.
All right.
Number one, I appreciate your staff. Every time I've gone to your office, they've treated me well and taken an attentive approach to hearing what I have to say.
Thank you very much.
Many of the things that could have been done here tonight could have been handled through visiting your office. So thank you.
And I encourage everybody to, if you have issues with the federal government, please come to the office. Whether you like me or agree with me or disagree with me, if you have issues with the federal government, please make an appointment and we can try to help you with that.
In recent years here in the government, you've turned more and more to using National Guard and military people, activating them, putting on active duty for periods of time. One of the questions on the current table right now is, should we treat them as veterans? If you bring a man on board and put him in harm's way on active duty, he is a veteran, and I hope you have that opinion of him. It's a question of benefits. and that is that the Veterans Administration still has problems processing our claims. Boise did a very good job, but now because there's still backlog in other areas, Oakland, for example, they're sending 2-year-old records from Oakland to Boise for them to process. So there's still a 2-year backlog in the system. So whatever we can do to help that out, I appreciate it.
You know Tori from my office, and she works really hard with the veterans and with the VA and all the different issues. But, you know, thank you for your service, and we will try to help you. If you know anybody who has issues with the Veterans Administration and the other issues, please send them to our office.
The only thing I would ask of you is please support the Guard Room and their efforts to be recognized as full military people.
We will definitely look at that. Thank you very much. We have one last question.
Thank you, Congressman. I'm sure you're aware of the trial going on in Las Vegas in federal court, the so-called Bundy Ranch standoff. I was down there for a total of about 5 days just observing the trial, and I guess there's some pretty serious allegations of some abuse of legal procedures, abuse of some of these prisoners in the prison down there. Some of those men are your constituents. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering if you've been looking into these things and what you've been doing as far as trying to get some justice, at least some fairness for these guys that are on trial for probably looking at jeopardy the rest of their lives in prison.
So I don't get involved in criminal trials. You know, as a congressman, in fact, it's not something that I can't get involved in. So that's what the lawyers for these defendants need to take care of. What I have looked at is whether, you know how this whole process started with what happened in Oregon. We need to figure out, that's one of the reasons I am for sentencing reform. You know, this whole incident started because we had a group of people who were prosecuted and sentenced to 5 years for a crime that even the judge said should have only been gone to jail for a few months. So that's why I have always been an advocate of sentencing reform. We should not have a system that is putting people in prison for a long period of time for crimes that should only be in prison for a short period of time. But the actual trial itself, it's not something that I can get involved in, and it shouldn't be something that I think members of Congress should get involved in. Anyway, thank you very much. I hope you all enjoyed that.